Earth was a very different place 419 million years ago. The planet was covered in vast oceans with enormous shallow seas surrounding what little there was of continental land masses. Some 200 million years before the dinosaurs ever existed, there was a group of highly successful arthropods that ruled over the seas and land. So successful, that they had a run of nearly 200 million years, during the Paleozoic era. In fact, their distant ancestors are still with us today. This is a summary infographic of the Eurypterids, in a time when land was virtually barren, and life was thriving mostly in the seas. It was the Eurypterids that were among the first living organisms to venture out onto land and eventually evolve into the largest arthropods that ever existed. Their body plan of a hard protective exoskeleton on the exterior and appendages for both walking and swimming, made them the most adaptable and dominant species of their time. Informally called sea scorpions, they evolved to fill different biological niches as swimmers, predators, scavengers, and opportunistic feeders. We know from fossil evidence that Eurypterids lived in both group and solitary lifestyles. They were members of the Chelicerate order, with no mandibles or antennae, placing them closer to living spiders, scorpions, and horseshoe crabs, rather than crustaceans, which is what is often assumed. While the majority of Eurypterid fossils indicate that they were on average about 7 inches in length, they ranged from only about an inch, to a massive 8 feet or more in length. The most numerous Eurypterid fossils are of Eurypterus remipes, a mid-Silurian genus that had both paddle and walking appendages and was about 5 to 9 inches in length on average. There is trace fossil evidence that some may have been up to over 4 feet long. Due to the abundance of fossils of them found there, Eurypterus remipes is the official state fossil of New York. Among the largest of all Eurypterids, is the group of pterygotids such as the enormous Gecalopterus. This Eurypterid was up to 8 feet long and weighed an estimated 854 pounds. Though as scary as these measurements may seem, recent research has indicated the large pterygotids were most likely just scavengers based on examinations of their eyes. Their eyesight would have been rather poor, making them good candidates for nocturnal scavengers. Eating any animal tissue that would have fallen to the sea bottom. The reality is that a great majority of Eurypterids were rather small and would have fit in the palm of your hand. Though you probably wouldn't want to. It is unknown what the telson, or the long stinger-looking tail, was actually used for with Eurypterids. It may have been a simply benign feature to help the Eurypterid flip back over while being on its back, similar to how horseshoe crabs use them. Or it could have been for piercing into the bodies of their prey, or possibly for a defense against other predators. While there is plenty of detailed information of Eurypterid anatomy available, I'll do a brief overview here. Eurypterids are composed of two suborders as defined by the morphology of their final pair of appendages. In the Eurypterina, the leg is modified into a broadened swimming paddle, while in the Stylonurina, this appendage has a long and slender profile, similar to living spiders and other arthropods. They both have the same body plan that is divided into three main sections: the prosoma, which is the head, the opisthosoma, the segmented body, and the stinger-like telson. Eurypterid track fossils give us an understanding of how they used these appendages as they moved around on different terrains. I was able to view Eurypterid tracks of fossilized mud recently in a museum. The Eurypterina would use their walking legs and paddle appendages to scuttle along a shallow pool of water. The paddle legs would move in a sweeping arc in conjunction with front legs darting forward and back. This can create a quick pulsing forward movement. It is estimated that smaller Eurypterids were quite agile and swift. It is unknown just how well they swam, but their wide distribution across the planet indicates that they were very adept at swimming. The Stylonurina suborder, on the other hand, could only move around by walking on their long spindly legs. Their legs were often much longer than Eurypterina and most likely was able to traverse over rugged terrain much more quickly than their counterparts. It would be analogous to them moving around like spiders. The very large Stylonurids, such as Hibbertopterus, moved in a very slow plodding fashion while dragging their telson behind, as known from fossil trackways. These would have been much, much larger than any spider living today, lucky for us. The horseshoe crab is a living fossil, as they have remained virtually unchanged in 300 million years. They are not crabs at all, but fellow chelicerates like the Eurypterids, scorpions, and spiders. They give us a glimpse at possibilities on Eurypterids' behavior such as mating and migration. It is not fully known whether Eurypterid were the apex predators of their time or just fellow scavengers like most trilobites were. The strongest evidence is that they were both, similar to how horseshoe crabs feed today. Some of the Eurypterid's attributes such as high mobility and excellent vision suggest that they would have been effective predators. The crescent-shaped eyes on a good majority of them would have provided 360-degree vision at all times. Not only 360 vision, but the ability to see both far and near at the same time based on the structure of their compound eyes. Like scorpions and spiders today, smaller and mid-sized Eurypterids would have most likely been ambush predators. Their dominance over vertebrates such as fish during much of the Paleozoic suggests that just about everything was on their menu that they could take down. Unlike fish and other small soft-bodied animals of the time, the Eurypterids had a plate of armor, their exoskeleton, to protect them from most defensive attacks. They could lie in wait on the sea bottom until prey became close enough, then pounced with barbed legs, wrapping and then rapidly cutting through the soft tissue with their sharp chelicerae. Given their abundance during the Paleozoic, trilobites would have been a food source for many animals at that time. Sea bottom dwelling and with vast populations, trilobites had evolved many defensive structures such as long spikes or thorns on their exoskeleton plating to ward off attacks. The fish during the Silurian period did not have developed jaws, which points to Eurypterids among their main predators. Soft-bodied marine worms, very well known from the fossil records of the era, would have provided a constant supply of food. Scavenging would have probably been part of the Eurypterids' diet, even for those that relied on predation as their staple. The myriad of dead and decomposing animal matter is a food source for many, if not most, of the marine species living today. Any and everything living or dead that falls to the seafloor is an available food source, and the Eurypterids would have had an advantage to get to it quickly and be able to guard it from other scavengers. The same scenario plays out today with most crustaceans and other benthic scavengers such as sea isopods. Sweep feeding has been suggested as one of the primary methods that some of the Eurypterina and most the Stylonurids use to capture prey. With sweep feeding, the prey is captured with the anterior appendages in rapid succession. Essentially, raking and grinding the small mollusks, worms and other soft-bodied-like organisms directly into the mouth cavity as they moved over the seafloor. The growth toward a very large body size and slower movement meant the Stylonurids during the late Silurian and early Devonian period could not actively and swiftly hunt prey like their quicker Eurypterina cousins. In all likelihood, Eurypterids were preying on other Eurypterids as well. When looking at fossils, it is sometimes difficult to accept that the extinct organism was an evolutionary success. The Eurypterids existed for over 200 million years, that's a very long time to keep on adapting, competing, and winning in the evolutionary arms race. Their success as a species would eventually come to an end with the culmination of mass extinction events and the rise of a group that couldn't seem to succeed very much in the prior periods. Our vertebrate great ancestors, the fish, made an evolutionary leap forward during the late Silurian period that would change everything and set a trajectory for us as humans living today. The development of jawed fish allowed vertebrates to turn the tables and become the apex predators and dominate in the millions of years up to the present. The fish during most of the early Paleozoic were just small vulnerable prey running and hiding as the best means to survive, now had become the ultimate predator with the ushering in of this new class of placoderms. The placoderms would dominate those shallow seas and drive the remaining Eurypterids of the Devonian period onto land, and now were on the run from these ultimate predators. With the ability to move swiftly, coupled with jaws and teeth capable of biting through and crushing hard exoskeletons, Eurypterids became the prey and merely a food source for these predatory armored fish. The large diversity of the prior Eurypterids went into a great decline during the early Devonian. The Stylonurids, such as Cocomoptera seen here, evolved to enormous sizes, living primarily out of the deeper sea and preferring muddy tidal flats to call home. The late Devonian mass extinction was the final blow to Eurypterids, with only Attilophthalmidae surviving into the following Carboniferous period. This mass extinction event would wipe out nearly 75% of all marine species. Plants began to cover the once barren landscape, and the ancestors of Eurypterids, the spiders and scorpions, evolved to fill various ecological niches just as their chelicerate forefathers had done before in those shallow Silurian seas. So, what were the Eurypterids? A highly successful group of marine arthropods that conquered their environment for 200 million years and gifted their genetic attributes to spiders, scorpions, and other chelicerates living today. They can inspire and teach us humans to persist, adapt, and evolve as our journey has just begun. Thank you for watching, and I hope this video was both educational and entertaining. Like and subscribe, and perhaps more content like this will be produced.